We're moving on to a few case studies of applications that we've been working on here at NERSC. And I'm going to go first. So I'm Tuomas Koskela again, and I work on a fusion particle in cell code called XGC1. And I'm going to talk about a bit of our recent work on running that on Cori KNLs. So here's a brief outline. I'm going to talk very quickly about magnetic fusion plasma simulations. Then I'm going to... So what most of this talk is focused on is not actually on XGC1, but a mini app that we developed to analyze the most expensive kernel of XGC. So I'm going to say a little bit about why we did that. Then, since I like roofline analysis so much, I'm going to show some roofline analysis, and then a few specific optimizations that we did using compiler reports this time, and show what kind of speedups we got. So XGC1 is a like I said, it's a particle in cell code for plasma physics simulations in fusion reactors, and it's particularly focused on what's called edge plasma region in a tokamak type reactors. So a tokamak is basically a torus, a donut shaped reactor, and here you see a slice through that torus. And what's of particular interest is this area here around the edges. So the magnetic field is set up in such a way that the hot plasma is in contact with the coal material walls only here at the bottom, and basically these blobs that you can see here developing here close to this gray X line determine how large is the heat flux to the surface of the reactor, and that basically determines whether you burn holes in your reactor or not. So understanding this turbulence is a big deal for the fusion community right now, going forward to larger experiments and eventually reactors. And what is challenging about this approach is that you cannot play certain tricks with the magnetic geometry that people have been doing for a long time. So XGC1 uses a Cartesian coordinate system and an unstructured mesh, which lets it resolve the magnetic field in the whole, I'm sorry, the magnetic electromagnetic fields in the whole domain. So what a basic particle in cell code does, it goes around this loop where it has a group of particles. You push the particles forward in time using an equation of motion. In collisional plasmas, you use a collision operator to take care of some collective small angle scatterings. Then you collect the charge from your particles to a mesh. You solve Maxwell's equations on the mesh to get your fields. Then you collect the fields back from the mesh to the particles, calculate forces on the particles, and you push the particles again. And you go around and around in this loop. So what's specific in XGC1 is, like I said, it has this complicated geometry that it deals with using a unstructured mesh in these cross planes of the torus. But since you get some benefit from approximately following the magnetic field with your mesh, there's a weird non-trivial mapping from one plane to the next. It's also what's called a full F code, so it simulates the whole distribution function and not a perturbation around an analytic solution. So it uses a huge number of particles, and in especially in large simulations, very large meshes as well. It uses what basically everyone in fusion is using, which is called gyrokinetic theory, which essentially reduces the dimensionality of the problem by one by averaging out one of the velocity space dimensions. This allows you to take much longer time steps for the particle pusher, but unfortunately it includes, a combination of using gyrokinetic theory and Cartesian coordinates makes you calculate higher order derivatives in your equations of motion, which adds some computational cost and also requires you to do some gyro averaging schemes when you're moving from the particles to the mesh and back. In addition, there's a trick to separate timescales called electron subcycling, which means that in this loop, for every particle push, you go into a separate subloop for every ion push, you go into a subloop for electrons, where you just subcycle through the electrons without doing the charge deposition field solve steps at all in between. So you let the fields evolve on a slower time scale. And this saves up a lot of computing time, but on the other hand, it means that that now the majority of your time is spent in this electron subcycling. So in fact, this is an example from Cori, where we run on 1,000 nodes, and this is the runtime spent by different kernels of the code, and the electron push is something like 80% of the total runtime. So it seems like a reasonable place to optimize, and in fact, if we look at the scaling, this is strong scaling on Cori, and in the electron push is the blue curve, and the red curve is the whole code. So and I think what the pie chart from the last slide was here in the middle. So you can see that the electron push is scaling almost perfectly, and the main code slows down a little bit when you scale it up. But essentially, what I'm trying to say here is that the electron push is taking up using the majority of the compute time, and if you can make it run fast on one node, it will run fast on as many nodes as you like. So that is why we started working on a mini app for the electron push, which we gave the name Toy Push, and it's a simple algorithm. So you initialize a group of particles, and you take a very simple unstructured mesh, which in the simplest case just has one triangle in it. So you put in a particle. You collect the fields from the mesh to the particle. You calculate the forces from those fields that are acting on the particle. You move the particle to a new position according to the equation of motion, and then interpolate again and just cycle through this and work on getting that running as fast as possible. I mean, what this simple case avoids is the trouble of figuring out how you move between cells. So we have another version that contains multiple mesh elements, and now you get into the issue of indirect or irregular memory accesses, let's say. So there's another step here where you now first have to figure out, okay, which cell am I in? So you do a search to find your nearest three nodes. And then after that, you use those nodes to interpolate the fields, move the particle, but now you might move into a different cell, and you will have to do the search again to find your new nearest three nodes. So you do the interpolation again. So you kind of might already begin to see what the optimization challenges here are. So I'm gonna focus. I think I'm gonna show the roofline plot next. Okay, yeah. So these are the three main kernels in the mini app. So you have the force calculation, the interpolation, and the search. And this is sort of was our starting point based on the on how the code was in XGC1. So I've plotted them here on the roof line, and the size of the markers on this plot corresponds to the computing, the CPU time, so they're all spending roughly equal amount of time. And we can see that the force calculation, because it's just doing flops, basically, it's doing vector multiplications, cross products. So it's performing pretty well on at the vector peak performance. It's not using FMAs very much, but I'm not gonna go into that. But the other two here are below the scalar peak performance. So that says that, okay, these two could do a better job. There's something wrong with these kernels. So this data was, we used Intel Vector Advisor tool, and we wrote the Python library PyAdvisor to analyze. So we dumped the data out of Intel Advisor into CSV files and then read it with a Python library and to generate these plots in case someone is interested. And these are, if these numbers are, correspond to a single core on KNL. So we started looking at the interpolation first, and the first thing we did, so this is using VTune. So we ran a VTune analysis, and basically what the VTune analysis was showing, flagging as a problem here, is the L1 hit rate. So we were not reusing L1 cache very well. So we optimized our cache blocking by changing the block size of the particles we were running through, and got a very good L1 hit rate up to around 99%. And I think this was, so we got something like a 1.5x improvement when running out of MC DRAM and 2x improvement running out of DDR. This was actually surprising because we didn't expect any difference between MC DRAM and DRAM. Basically, we don't need that memory bandwidth here. We're more bound by the latency. But I'll get back to that, why there was a difference here. So the next issue that came up in the interpolation was the indirect access to the grid node data. So basically, when the particle finds its nearest three grid nodes, then it needs to go through the index of the triangle it's in to the grid nodes that make up the triangle, to the fields that are stored on the grid nodes. And this was generating indirect accesses. So this is, we looked at the compiler reports that the Intel compiler gives out when it tries to vectorize. And basically you see these, well, the bottom line here is basically saying that there are 18 gather loads per one iteration of the loop, and that seemed to be what was hurting the performance and preventing the like a good vector performance. So the loop was being vectorized, but it was being vectorized with a lot of gather instructions that are just terribly slow. So what we did was we changed the algorithm a little bit. So we group particles that are accessing the same triangle. So if you remember from the beginning, in XGC1 we have something like 10,000 particles per cell. So essentially you can most of the time operate on particles that are in the same triangle. You don't need actually to do this indirect accessing more than once. And so we did that. We grouped the particles together. And of course, for the simple code version, this is kind of trivial. This is what should have been done in the first place. But for the multiple, for the code with multiple elements, you need to add a bit of extra logic that added a small overhead, but was still very much beneficial. So now we got rid of the gathers here in the compiler report and just have units threaded, loads and stores left. We also added a line like a compiler directive to align the arrays, which you can see on the report as it's reporting aligned accesses. And this was something like 1.6x improvement to the whole code. I think it was something like 3x to the interpolation kernel. So basically going from no vectorization benefit at all to close to the 4x that is possible in KNL. Okay, so this is the problem that we had with memory, is that we were initializing large arrays with the AVX512 memset function, which turns out to be surprisingly slow for large arrays, and it was consuming a lot of memory bandwidth. So this we could also see this from the compiler report, although it's not exactly clear that this is a bottleneck before you analyze it further. So we analyzed this with VTune and saw that the memset function was taking a significant fraction of time. And basically, fixing this for us was pretty simple. So we just initialized the array one loop iteration at a time, but as we need it. But the other option would be to initialize with threads, so that you don't you have less burden on one core. So this actually the improvement from this was pretty small, since we had already done that other memory optimization I was talking about. But this pretty much brought our DRAM and MC DRAM performance to the same level, which is what we were expecting. Okay, briefly, the search is a tricky function to vectorize because the trip counts of the loops are undefined. You loop until the search finds what it's looking for and then exits. In our case, we found it was beneficial to actually make the search loop not exit upon completion, but just keep it running and mask out the iterations that we're not interested in. So by doing that, we got from this report where the compiler was saying cannot vectorize this because you have multiple exit conditions to vectorizing with decent efficiency. And this was, again, another 1.5x improvement to the performance of the whole code. So I want to show how this looked on the roofline. So this is the starting point where we were. And after the optimizations to the search and interpolation, they move up on the roofline. And keep in mind that the size corresponds to the runtime. So the interpolation is roughly 10 times smaller, and it's actually performing very close to the maximum possible. The search went up by about 3x. It's actually, you notice here that it moves, it loses some arithmetic intensity because of the vectorization, because of the data alignment, basically. So the vector loads are now bringing in some stuff from memory that we don't need. But we're still seeing a speed up, and finally, so we put some of these optimizations back into the XGC1 electron push. It's still work in progress. Some of the things are complicated to port, but we got the electron push down by about 3x. It's still, so this is still on 1,000 nodes. It's still the most expensive part, but not as dramatically as before. And we're actually running into a situation now where the Poisson solve is getting more expensive due to MPI communications, and that's what we're working on right now. So, okay, I guess I used up my time, but okay. Well, this is just a quick summary. So XGC1 is in many cases quite an extreme example of a fusion particle in cell code due to the mesh and geometry it uses and the full F algorithm that's not used by everyone. We use an electron subcycling, which is a pretty common trick in fusion PIC codes, to basically say we're not interested in what happens at the electron timescale. We just want to move the electrons and analyze the plasma turbulence at the ion timescale. This saves time, computing time, but because of that, most of the CPU time is spent in the electron push, just because the time step of the electrons is so much shorter than the time step of the ions. The electron push subcycle has almost no communication, so it's sort of dominated by the on-node performance, and it's almost like embarrassingly parallel. You just need to get as much performance out of the core as you can, and it will run quickly. So we developed a mini app to mock the electron push in XGC and optimized it and identified the main bottlenecks in the grid search and interpolation, and successfully vectorized them and pushed them pretty close to the maximum attainable performance on the roofline chart. And we're still working on porting all of this optimization back into XGC1, but we've seen about a 3x speed up in the electron push already, and we're kind of getting to the point where we're starting to look at other kernels in XGC1 for optimization. So thank you.
Do we have the chance to ask a question?
Sure.
So when you move from one triangle, in this case, to another, are you actually searching, or are you detecting edge crossings and figuring out where you go in a deterministic way?
We are not detecting edge crossings, so we are searching. So because, I mean, the particle push itself, it doesn't move in terms of triangles. I mean, it moves in terms of real space coordinates. So
yeah,
we don't have that information easily available of which triangle edge we cross.
At the beginning and end of a step, you've got a number that tells you which side of a plane you're on.
Right.
And you can detect that the
okay, so there is
which case it should be determined.
Yeah. Well, there is another complication, which is the 3D structure of the meshes. So when the particle moves from one 2D plane to another, there is a mapping that actually means it can cross more than one triangle. So it typically, when particles move from out of the triangle, they move that their destination is not a neighbor of the triangle, but it's somewhere completely different. So that I mean, you can still do this, but you have to do it in 3D, and you have to take all these mappings into account. So we are thinking about it, but it is fairly complicated.